You know, it looks bleached out because it's so hot, baby. Really hot today, 100 degrees here in the Bay Area of California. South Bay. It's cooking, which is great. So, this appearance, it looks cool to me somehow. Or maybe it looks like white hot. I don't know. What we need to do here is to make our intentions clear. Okay, we have to clarify our intentions. What do we intend? We intend to see the world as emphasizing intrinsic spaciousness. That's it. That's our intent. That's it. So let's just laser focus on that. So when we know what we want, we focus on what we want. When we get what we want, we're not surprised. We say, this is what I want. This is what I truly want. Make this commitment. And we've heard the dream that the world will seem like transparent, almost. Not in a feeling way. It has this feel of transparency, and everything's kind of floating and very tenuous and like mist almost, because everything is decoration of intrinsic spaciousness. We see everything is just the same, and that it's all just mere decoration of intrinsic spaciousness. There isn't anything other than that, actually. It's not anything other than that. It's not anything other than that. This is guru vision. So our goal is guru vision of intrinsic spaciousness, to see the world this way, to see this crazy existence that we have. Well, I have my uncle, my cousin, Uncle Ross. He helps out with that, and my friend Juan Carlos. He also helps out. So we got some different friends in. We got some helpers. I'm bringing some helpers in. And then here we practice. How about that? Actually practice. So we're going to practice now, just focusing our intent on what we really want. Our intent is to emphasize intrinsic spaciousness. Now I know this is possible because I've shifted into it several times. And it's just an easy little tip of our attention. Somehow just some little pivot, a little easy pivot. And you become aware of intrinsic spaciousness, and this is what's primary now. That's all it is. This is the remedy. This is the cure for our troubles. I know everybody else is talking, 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 positivity, non-dual, you know, praise the gurus, all this stuff. That's great. But that's not the remedy. As Ramana said, all talk is just talk. All heart talk is just talk. It's like saying the name of medicine with reverence instead of taking the medicine. Ramana is wonderful. He was so plain, direct, spoken, ascetic, and he simply had no fear of telling it like it really is. And it's very helpful. We have to take the medicine. So the medicine is vision of intrinsic spaciousness. That's the only medicine there is. We get used to recognizing there's no modification really taking place at all. And then from there, we can truly function the way we really want to function. Instead of trying to modify our functioning, we accept our functioning as it is and function perfectly. But right now, we're waiting on existence to change what we are. So we're just basically, everyone's actually just waiting. In this vision that I had, it was daytime, and I just shifted, and I saw all of us, one spiritual family. But everybody was just like standing idly by, not doing anything, just waiting. I said, "Everyone's just waiting. What are they waiting for?" And I couldn't communicate with them, couldn't relate, because they're just like We're just waiting, you know, just waiting like this, like sort of paralyzed, fixated on waiting. What are they waiting for? They're waiting to be modified. And they wait in vain. They wait in vain. And so I was like, wow. How amazing. They're just all, I'm so happy to see none of them have been modified. And yet they're not much fun as they just sit there waiting for the existence to modify what they are. That's all that we're doing. We're spirit. We're just witnessing all this, hoping that it'll modify. It won't. So what do we do with existence then? Give it a different purpose, which is to reflect intrinsic spaciousness, be aware of intrinsic spaciousness. And all of this stuff is merely like a painting, you know, a decoration, ornamentation. We've just made all this ornamentation, beautiful ornamentation of intrinsic spaciousness, and that's all that it is. And we can literally experience this. Not as a one-off, like, oh, that was some mystical thing. No, it has a different purpose for dreaming, different purpose for existence. We don't want to just have it disappear on us as a continuity fear problem. So we'll just give it a different purpose. So I, in my experiencing, I have experienced this. So I know it's possible. In fact, it's not only possible, it's easy. It's easy to shift, but then we say, whoa, you know, what? That was so easy. You know, how could it be so easy? Right? It's like, wow, amazing. And then we don't stay in it. This is our tendency. If you stay in it, then you're a guru. If you don't stay in it, but you go into it and you can be a Dharma prince if you're really determined. But still, you're working to be a guru. Guru in training. You know, you're working to abide in it all the time. So say, above all else, today I am determined to see. I am determined to see intrinsic spaciousness as all that I see, as the emphasis that I see. I am determined to see intrinsic spaciousness as the emphasis that I see. And everything else, everything is just beautiful ornamentation. The insects flying around, just beautiful ornamentation of intrinsic spaciousness. So make the intent clear to you. Say, light, this is what I choose to see now. When you're seeing this, labels don't matter anymore. Whether you say, I'm enlightened, I'm not enlightened, all this, it doesn't matter. There's no struggle anymore. We're taking the medicine. If we don't take the medicine, then labels are so important. Like, I'm labeling it this, I'm labeling it that. And you're thinking, maybe this label will work. And yet we're avoiding taking the medicine. So none of the labels work. There's not labels that are bad in themselves. It's just that we're using them as an excuse to not drink the medicine, not take the medicine of vision, of intrinsic spaciousness. So we let everything just be exactly as it is this instant. And we shift our attention now to the emphasis on intrinsic spaciousness. I have a Facebook friend who said that goodbye to everyone. He's going into silence. He said, well, okay. Well, maybe that's a sign for all of us, right? It's time to go into what? Into our intent. Focus on our intent at this point. So it's great. His is silence. Great. Ours here, we don't need to be silent. Silence is also, conversation is also silence. Words are also silence. Everything is intrinsic spaciousness. That's, we might say, it's silent. It has nothing to say in terms of modification. There's no modification to report. Silence is basically no modification to report. It's not an absence. It's not a vacuum. It's not an abyss. It's just there's no modification taking place. And words and labels are based on the belief in modification. So truth is silent, meaning it doesn't have anything to report. No news to report. Like, today, you know, this sector of reality was modified or something. There's no modification taking place. No news, no news, no news to report, no news to report. So we need to now start, lock in, pull the alarm, you know, call the fire department, and decide that this is what we're going to do. This is what we're doing. Now, there doesn't seem to be anybody else doing that. Well, if you're doing it, I'm doing it. Keep that in mind. But I haven't found anyone really on Facebook as far as looking around. There's some of you watching the videos that will do it. Yeah. But as far as just fishing around on Facebook, no, I haven't found anyone that will actually do it. They talk a good game, but they won't drink the medicine. So what good is that? Talking a good game, what good is that? They just become superposers. You can become a superposer if you want, but what good is that? Now, I'm kind of worried about my situation here because it's a crisis in terms of work and money and all of that. I think probably maybe a lot of you are having a crisis, and so I took a nap this afternoon and I said, "Hey, Manjushri Bodhisattva Longchenpa, my intrinsic spaciousness gurus, what do you say?" And they said, "Well, don't ask for anything specific. Just ask for our blessing, which is 360 degrees. It's in all ways. So don't we usually ask for something specific?" But they said, "Don't ask for anything specific. That's the wrong way to pray. Just ask for everything." Ask it to be helped. Ask to be helped in every way. Ask to be helped in every way. Otherwise, you're going to believe in separation and fragmentation, which is modification. Ask to be helped in every way. So I did. Okay, I'm not praying for anything in particular. I'm just saying 360 degree, I accept the blessings you have for me in every direction. Wonderfully abstract prayer, isn't it? And then I kind of fell asleep and I had this sort of dream where there's this big old block of a big, huge bundle, a square bundle of hay. So many bales of hay, all bundled together really tightly. Beautiful, beautiful hay. Really, really fresh, great hay. And then around it was extra. There's a whole bunch stacked around, but in the middle was this big, oh, huge block, enough hay to last a long time. So, that was a sign that, you know, they set aside some provisions for me somehow, because I sure don't have them right now, I'll tell you that. It's like I'm sinking. Finances have, you know, dried up. It's like, okay, well, I just trusted that, you know, they will provide. But I don't ask for financial help or anything. I just ask for all help. So can we at least make that shift in our practicing, in our prayers? Because we all are asking for something now, help, right? So just ask for all help. Let me be helped in every way. Let all beings be helped in every direction, 360 degree direction. A spherical 360 degree, all help in every wayness. So may I be helped in every way. May I be helped in every way. I accept every a complete help. I accept complete help in every direction. Now, isn't this what the vision of intrinsic spaciousness is all about? In every direction you look, it's intrinsic spaciousness you see, and the decorations, everything's just a decoration of it. Well, that, yeah. It's not like over there I see it, that tree I see it, but over here it's not that way. As Jesus says, you can either see this world or the real world. You can't see both. You can't see both. Here we see the vision of otherness, which gives us this plausible belief in modification. Okay, that's all we see here. When we shift our attention to vision of intrinsic spaciousness, we see everything as decoration of intrinsic spaciousness. No modification taking place. If you see any modification, anything you see think is modification, then you believe in modification, plain and simple. That's what it's witnessing to. And you don't believe that it's impossible. So you either believe it's possible or not possible. In this, there's no wiggle room at all. Either we can modify what we are or we can't. Okay? You can't have it both ways here. You can practice canceling out concepts. Fine. That's a practice. But in truth, you can't have it both ways. It's impossible. So we choose the perception that supports the position we want to experience. If we want to experience that we can modify what we are, we'll choose to see through the body senses. We see this universe through the body senses. If we choose to accept that we cannot modify what we are, then we will spiritually perceive this universe as intrinsic spaciousness, and everything arising in it as mere decoration and ornamentation of it. Already that way. It arises as that, and it dissolves as that. The arising and the abiding and the dissolving of all appearances is the same. It never leaves its decorationness of intrinsic spaciousness. It never becomes anything other than that. Someone out. We'll see. Just one moment here. But just sit here like this and say, okay, we've set our resolve. This is what we have to do. That's very simple. Very simple. And we don't need to be going around doing a whole bunch of other stuff. Second here. Trying to do a good deed. No good deed goes unpunished. Keep that in mind. Keep that in mind. So yeah, don't think that we do good deeds that it'll be great. No, 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 no. We'll be punished for it. Okay. Always, right? Okay, So, no ride, no ride. I thought I'd text in time, but no. Okay, great. So we can spend a little more time here. So we just say, I am going to be experiencing intrinsic vision of intrinsic spaciousness. That's what I'm going to be experiencing. And the odd part of it is that you see everyone, all your brothers in spirit, the one spiritual family, they're all just kind of standing like zombies. They're fine, but they seem to be not communicating with you at all because they're waiting for modification to take place. You know it won't take place, so some will be irritated with you, you know, like, hey, what are you doing buzzing around like a fly, you know, quiet. We're waiting for modification. It could happen any moment. You know, don't interfere. How could anything modify its own intrinsic spaciousness? At what point is the intrinsic spaciousness modified? At what point is intrinsic spaciousness modified? When it arises, when it's just growing, plateauing, shrinking, dissolving, when does intrinsic spaciousness become modified? Just because the decoration disappears, that intrinsic spaciousness has been modified? That's like stuff disappearing on a television, a computer screen, and then say, oh, the computer screen's been modified. Like, what? If I disappear here from the picture, it's like, oh my gosh, you know, it's been modified. It's no longer, the screen's no longer the same. Oh, terrible. How does that work? So what we're going to do is abide in this, you know, emphasizing intrinsic spaciousness. That's all. We could either emphasize one or the other. That's it. That's a choice we have. We either emphasize otherness. We either emphasize the belief in modification, or we emphasize the belief in non-modification. It's the only choice we have to make here. That's it. There isn't any other choice at all. So it's either one or the other. And everyone talks about diversity in this world, right? Oh, yeah, I'm very diverse. Well, okay, let's have half of the world believe in non-modification and half believe in modification. Let's start there as a start for diversity. You get any takers on that? One, two, couple, three, four, okay, couple. Other than that, no takers. So what is this diversity they're talking about? So let's be very diverse in our belief in modification. Is that what they're saying? Sounds like it, doesn't it? And they're saying, God, we're too busy. We're working so hard on diversity here. For diversity training, we want lots of diverse expressions of modification. And God says, well, that's just all the same silly notion, belief in modification. It's all exactly the same. What do you mean? All sorts of different angles. It's all the same. They say, no, this one over here believes in modification, and this one over here believes in modification, but they think that the tree is it, and they think the ground is it, and they think that there's a... God says, it's the same belief. Belief in modification. It's not different at all. Now, who are you trying to fool? And so we just have this... Either we emphasize our belief in modification, or we emphasize our belief in non-modification. That's the only choice we have to make. It's so simple. So, again, in the spirit of progressive diversity, let's have half of the world believe in one and half of the world believe in the other. And until we get to half and half, let's not have any words, you know? what is there to say? I mean, we got to be busy making sure we're diverse and balanced and integrated and all the wonderful ideals we hear out in the world talk about constantly. So let's get half and half, and then we'll talk about how wonderfully diverse the world is. Now we're just making a point. Of course, people, they won't stand for that. They will not, right? You're crazy, they'll say. And yet it's plain as day, isn't it? How could you call everybody believing in the same belief in modification, how can you call that a diversity of belief, a world that has diversity of belief? This is absurdity, isn't it? This is absurdity. And everybody here wants to say, yeah, but we can be happily absurd. Really? Believing in modification? Then you have to try and somehow get rid of God. Because God knows there's no such thing as modification and modifying his ideas. It actually leads to just mental illness, severe psychosis, actually. You know, so absurdity leads to severe psychosis. Believing in modification leads to severe psychosis, and that's terrible. So, you know, we're not going to listen to these people who are headed for a psychosis, that they think that's the remedy for us. That's what the world thinks, I know. I said, okay, world, I'll do what you want me to do. Let's see how it turns out. Severe psychosis, okay. This is what happens. This is what the world is headed for. And so why should we go along with that? We're not going to go along with that. For what? So we all suffer together, suffer severe psychosis together? Well, guess what? That isn't going to do any good. When you're in a severe psychosis, it doesn't matter if others are suffering along with you. That doesn't matter at all. Doesn't matter. So this idea of misery loves company is not true. It's not going to be true. You see everybody as an enemy. You see everything as a threat. You know, doesn't matter if they're suffering or not. So this is what we're being told is what's good for us. It'll shape us up. What do you mean shape us up? You mean modify us is what is meant. And no, it won't modify us. You can stay in a severe psychosis for as long as you want. It won't modify what we are, awareness, pure intrinsic spaciousness. It won't modify it at all. Intrinsic spaciousness is not modified, not modifiable. So we're just asked to spend our time futilely, doing nothing, going into a severe psychosis, suffering hideously, all this stuff, all for nothing. What is that? Just ridiculous whimsicality or just being totally unfair? Stupid, unfair, you know, it's not adventurous because it just goes nowhere. Instead of except into a psychosis, which is, you know, like a black hole of despair. And yet this is what everyone in the world, almost everyone, is insisting that this is what we all have to do. Even the best of people here, this is what they're still insisting on. The leaders, everybody, with some exceptions of those who are, you know, super determined to get free of this. So we're not going to entertain any discourse with these folks until it's balanced out. At least that balanced out, right? Otherwise, it completely, what is there to talk about? They say one thing and do another. That's not talk. That's sabotage. So we're not going to let ourselves be sabotaged out of happiness. Why should we? Said who? By whose authority are we supposed to accept being sabotaged out of our happiness? By what authority? Authority of arrogance? What authority does arrogance have over? What kind of natural authority does arrogance have? It doesn't have any. So we're supposed to believe in following no authority as our new authority now is no authority. I don't know. I'm not willing to do that right now. Maybe later I'll be stupid again, but not right now. And yet everyone expects you to just walk down that primrose path into the black hole of despair. I say, we're all doing it. It must be right. Now, this world is a place where we have a temper tantrum. This is where we find ourselves. When we throw a temper tantrum, and it was like everyone here is like on a hunger strike, you know. I'm not going to eat anything. Not until you say you're sorry, God, you know, for causing me all these problems. So, if we have a temper tantrum. In the afterlife, we find ourselves back here again. And, of course, we do have temper tantrums in the afterlife because even then, God, you know, doesn't relent about modification. We can't even in the afterlife, we can't modify reality. So we throw a temper tantrum ultimately. Then we find ourselves back here and say, I'll show you. I'll go on a hunger strike. You know, I'll get so much despair, God, I will modify what I am. Believe me. And you're going to regret it. And so, yeah. We find ourselves here. This here is just all these pouty, throwing a childish pouty temper tantrum. I'm gonna come. I'm gonna die, God. You'll see. That'll modify me. You think I can't be modified? I'll show you. I'll show you. Death is gonna modify me. Modify. So I'm gonna go. I'm gonna go there and die. Temper tantrum. That's all. Ah, the sun. I was up early this morning. Well, I wasn't up. I shouldn't say that. Shh, I can't say that. Juan Carlos was up. Juan Carlos was up with the early morning sun. And I did some taping, let's say. Let's put it that way. I taped. I say, well, I don't know how it was done. I can't say how it was done. But the morning sun, the sun... just going over the mountains, like this golden light, just boom, hitting, you know, right in the eyes, and then now it's setting down today, setting. So it's been from early morning to evening here, taping all day, focusing all day, not working. This is very bad. It's a crisis, you know, 360-degree crisis. So view your crisis as 360 degrees and ask for 360-degree help. Help in every direction. Now you're asking God to help out. If you ask for help in a specific direction, you're asking the ego to help out. Ask God's always only everything, you know, all directions. There's no miracle that's more difficult than another for God. So ask for all miracles, miracles in all directions. Just ask for 360-degree help, God. We're just asking for that. And along with that comes vision of intrinsic spaciousness, right? 360-degree. We're asking God for 360-degree vision of intrinsic spaciousness. 360-degree. Okay. So let's feel this as opposed to something that's just like ahead of me, like I'm looking ahead and that, and I'm seeing that intrinsic spaciousness there, but over here I'm not so sure. No, let's get this feeling of being immersed, 360-degree immersion in intrinsic spaciousness, vision of intrinsic spaciousness. So imagine we're out in the middle of this vast Pacific Ocean, and we look here, and all we see is the ocean. We look here, all we see is the ocean. We look there. We turn around. All there is the ocean. So we're turning around. Imagine we're on this little swivel that is like a little turntable. The turntable's going around slowly. And so we just get to see. And every direction we see, it's absolutely the same. Okay, we're in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. Nice and calm. Pacific Ocean's peaceful, and all we see is just endless water. So put yourself there mentally, as if you're there. So the turntable is turning slowly. And you've been on the turntable now for quite some time. And you're not keeping track of revolutions. And you don't know if it's gone a full revolution or not, but you know you've been on it for such a long time now. You suspect that it may have gone all the way around. But you don't really know, because everything looks exactly the same. So how can you know for sure? You're dipping your feet in the water, nice cool water, refreshing. And you're just revolving on this turntable in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. Seamless panorama. Absolutely seamless panorama. Not a seam to be seen anywhere. And we just keep revolving on this revolving disc that we're sitting on. And all day long, we're just seeing this all day long. We'll just stay on it all day. Perfect visibility, and no matter where we look, it just stretches on and on and on to the horizon of light. So it's all 360 degrees, it's all the same, isn't it? So we realize when we do this, so this is what the gurus have done. That's all they've done. They didn't really have any attainments. They just accepted this different purpose for dreaming. They just chose this different purpose for dreaming. And everything just appears to them as this beautiful display of ornamentation, of intrinsic spaciousness. And that's it. They just get used to it. So it's easy to be a guru, right? We're not attainment gurus. We're natural gurus. Natural. No attainment gurus. Familiarity gurus. We're just getting familiar with how it is. A lot of people want attainment gurus because they think that then this guru can modify God. Say, oh, you're so good at modifying yourself, you're so good at modifying something with an attainment that you must have the secret for modifying yourself. So you can do that for us, and then we're all safe. You know, we don't have to deal with our continuity fear and all this stuff. So this is what most want. They want you to jump through hoops. if you want to help the mass, if you want to help me out, you have to prove that you can modify, you know, you're capable of modification. I want to see the evidence. Here, we're not doing anything except just giving a different purpose to dreaming, different purpose to this dream of existence. It's just emphasize intrinsic spaciousness. It's already there. It's just we're blind to it because that's our purpose, is to be blind to it. So our purpose has been to be blind, and now our purpose is to not be blind. It's very simple. We're not chasing after any attainment as a blind, someone who's blind. What is that? Just choose to not be blind. But instead, everybody is trying to get some sort of attainment out of blindness. Why? Keeps them waiting. That's what spirit wants. It wants this spirit just waiting for, and wants to see modification, 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 and waiting for its own modification. So spirit says, everybody you hear, this world is going through so much modification, but you're not giving me any modification. I hate you, you know. This is where the angry God belief comes into. We're just disappointed in our dream that it's not modifying us, so we're angry with the dream. You know, not realizing that we're the ones doing the dream. We so in order to be angry at it, we think, oh no, it's not our dream. So we blame the dream for failing to modify us, you know. And then we think that then that God's angry at us. That's how we misinterpret it. It's an angry God, Jehovah, saying, you're terrible. You haven't done what I told you to do, you stupid humans. I wanted to be modified and you failed to do so. I will smite ye. So our intent is to drop the blindness, that's all. Take off the blinders. Now, we may have to hang out with some gurus in order to do this, because the rest of the world just says, no, you can't do that. You're crazy, you know, all this stuff. So we may need to hang out with someone who says, yeah, no, this is fine. You can hang out with me. Don't worry. All we need is one, right? A friend who says, oh, no, I don't care if the whole world rejects you. You can hang out with me. Not a problem. Because pretty much the whole world will reject you. Those who choose, you know, to drop, you know, the blinders and see intrinsic spaciousness. The rest of the world doesn't want that. They say, no, we've almost got the modification here. That's terrible, terrible example. Stop doing that. So the guru is just someone who won't reject you if you choose vision of intrinsic spaciousness. They won't reject you. They'll say, welcome aboard. We were expecting you. Okay. difficult, but we have to do it. So, Juan Carlos is like a guru figure. No problem for him. Welcome, you know. You want to hang out with me? Well, yeah. You gotta find me first. Now you gotta ask. You gotta ask first, right? Might be a real good idea if I have a guru, that I'm aware of a guru that's hanging out with me. Now gurus can bilocate. In fact, they can multilocate. So if all of us call upon the same guru, they can all appear for us, all of us. Now, they might be able to just appear subtly for us. I don't know how this is going to work, but it may be we need that. And if people say, you can't do that, well, the guru says, they asked me, I'm doing it. That's what I am. That's what I do. So they won't leave you. Now, is this possible? I believe it is. Somehow it has to work. Somehow it has to work. So we're loosening up our constraints. You know, we've been so constrained by the blind saying, you can't do this, you can't do this, you can't do this. You got to stay blind like the rest of us. Excuse me? You mean I got to stay unhappy and go towards psychosis like the rest of you? I've already been there, done that. There's nothing there for me. Nothing there for me. So I've just got to believe that nothing can make me happy, you know? Meaning psychosis is supposed to make me happy? No, it doesn't. So what am I supposed to do? Just do it again? That's insanity. Doing the same thing, expecting a different result? So you just want me to be insane? And no, not right now. I'm not into that. I have options. And they say, no, you don't have any options. Well, this is where the guru must come into the picture. So, Juan Carlos videos are designed for us to get used to the idea of the guru coming into the picture. Okay, so I'm helping out with that. They asked me to do this, the gurus, because we're having trouble with it. So we got to at least get some impression, get you know, start going down that road. Like, hey, the guru is going to show up for me. That's their job. That's what they do. That's what they're for. Those who want the vision of intrinsic spaciousness, the guru shows up. Plain and simple. And like I said, there's no limit to the number of show-ups that they can do simultaneously. So don't worry about that. Don't say, well, you know, they made this thing like there's only Jesus is it. There's only be in one place at one time. So if Jesus shows up with you, they can't show up with you over there. That's nonsense. That's an attempt, you know, to intimidate us away from choosing the vision of intrinsic spaciousness and getting help with that. Jesus can show up as many places at once simultaneously as he wants to, or as he is asked to do. There's no limit. He can show up a trillion places at once, all functioning exactly the way that we ask him to function there as a friend. There's nothing for him. This is the capacity the one mind of God has. Okay, and we're all that one mind. There's nothing outside of that one mind. So how could we be different other than that one mind? It's impossible. If there's only one mind, we have to be it, right? Yeah. It's wonderful, sultry evening. I wish it was even a little hotter. Love it. It's getting, you know, pretty late. Was the 19th of September? Holy cow, the 21st of September is coming up. Wow. We really need the guru to show up. So, I am pioneering this path of Juan Carlos. Is this, this sort of, this figure, you know, like, where did Juan Carlos come from? How do we find him? Yeah. We got to go find Juan Carlos. We got to find the guru. He just shows up. There he is. He's close, you know, he could show up. You never know when he's going to show up. He might show up. This is very helpful to at least get relaxed, have a good laugh, get relaxed, and say, you know, it's like, okay, you know, Let's start loosening the constraints, the straitjacket. So, I'm asking in my dreams first, at least. Show up, to Guru. It's time for you to show up and hang out in the dream. And just hang out. And we need to keep doing it. We start doing it every day, every day, every day, every day. So we need to have this feeling that we're hanging out with a friend who won't abandon us when the world abandons us, as it most certainly will. That's what I've experienced. You start talking like this, nobody wants anything to do with you. They just want to find some otherness, which is makes them happy. Some special relationship with whatever. And then, you know, call it non-dual and call it good. Or they want to have something non-dual and the rest, you know, not. Can't have that. So it's 360 degree intrinsic spaciousness, vision of intrinsic spaciousness. Now don't put the guru to the test, just be quiet. And we'll find out, right? We'll see. Don't say, oh, I know you're going to abandon me, so you might as well do it right now. You know, that's stupid, okay? Just say, look, I don't know. Just wow. I'm just going to wow it. I'm going to wow your presence. That's all. I'm not going to dialogue with you. I'm not going to ask questions. I'm not going to either. Because that's putting the whole situation on the spot in a slippery slope. Just say, look, okay, the guru's here. Wow. That's it. Wow. Guru's here. Wow. Ah, I smell something very nice. Barbecue. Someone's barbecuing on a super hot evening. Very nice. It's so hot the flies are out and the crickets are quiet. I don't know why they're quiet. They should start in pretty soon, shouldn't they? Yeah. You don't think they're overheated by now, the crickets? Are you kidding? It's a blistering hot day. I got up early in the morning and right away went outside and it's like balmy. And I said, oh, wow. You know, t-shirt, well, no chill in the air at all. No feeling of being cold in the early morning, the dawn. And I said, this is going to be a real hot day today for sure. And you look at the stupid weather forecasters and, you know, one of them says, you know, 86. Other says 92. Okay, well, they missed it. One missed it by 14 degrees. The other missed it by 8 degrees. I mean, it's 100. They just can't forecast the weather anymore. And it's weird. People are now starting to think that your thermometer is wrong and the weather people are right. This is the false authority. People get so used to false authority that they reject true authority. This is why we need the gurus with us, true authority. And they can say, well, look, you don't have to look at me as a guru or not. Doesn't matter. I'm not going to leave you unless you insist that I leave you. I'm going to stay here as your friend. Through thick and thin. That's what they say, oh, what a friend we have in Jesus. I'm going to stay with you through thick and thin. I don't care what anyone says. Whatever they say, I'm not leaving you. And even if you stop seeing me, I'm still here. Okay, I'm not leaving. Because the world most certainly is going to believe in false authority. You know, they have been practicing that to an extreme extent. Keep in mind these politicians, these leaders, these celebrities, it's just practice for us to follow false authority is what it is. So we got really used to it. And then it gets worse and worse and worse. Pretty soon we'll all be following machines. I had this message on the car, check gas cap, check gas. I just kept doing it, check. I was like, whoa, what's wrong? So I was in a traffic light. I jumped down, checked the gas cap. It's fine. I get back in the vehicle, say, okay, it's fine. It's still saying, I say, oh my gosh, there's really something I got to check here. So I pull off the side of the road. I get out, I take the gas cap off, I replace it just right, put it on, it's perfect, you know. Go back in the car, still check gas cap, check gas. I was like, oh, like getting nervous. Like, oh, I must be wrong. Not the machine is wrong. I must be wrong. You see that? So finally, I just hit this button that cycles through a number of screens, so I just didn't see the screen anymore. You know, there's nothing wrong with the gas cap, but there's something wrong with the technology. But what's happening now is we're getting to the point where we will believe that when technology goes bad, it's not the technology is going bad, it's we're going bad. You see how dangerous technology is and the cult of technology of believing in it? So there's nothing wrong with my gas cap at all. Everything's perfect. It's the technology that's having a glitch. But we are very close to feeling like if the technology tells us something, that we have to obey it. That's like God talking to us. Seriously. It almost felt like that. It's like, oh, I've got to check it. I must be wrong. You know, something wrong with me. The technology's never wrong. It's wrong a lot. One vehicle, the oil gauge says zero. Oil pressure gauge, zero. I've been riding that with a long time. And I asked the mechanic, I said, oh, they do it all the time. Those gauges that go out, your oil pressure's fine. I said, yeah, but how can I drive it? I might burn the engine. He says, no, it's just a malfunction of the gauge. These vehicles these days, all sorts of technical malfunctions happen. I said, really? He says, yeah. That's terrible. We believe in technology so much. We've been brainwashed into thinking it's so infallible that we think that we're the ones who are wrong when technology tells us something that's obviously wrong, that our intuition is wrong. So we stop trusting our intuition. So it's a catastrophe in the world right now. We stop trusting our intuition. So let's ask the gurus to show up right now, in this taping, right here in our vicinity, and put them on notice that this is what we're requesting. It doesn't have to be in a personal form. It could be a ball of light. It could be something subtle, an aroma, or, you know, they could show up any which way. I just say, Guru, show up in some way and stay with us now. That's it. I feel it's time for us to do this. It could show up as a sound, some music or some sound or a feeling. A fragrance, a feeling, a sound, a sensation, something, you know, whatever it may be. Maybe there's many, many ways. But to show up and just stay, be present with us. You know, the odor of sanctity, they say, right? That's something, the odor of sanctity. The fragrance of sanctity. But I tell you, this barbecue smell sure smells good. I wouldn't mind if that stuck around. That's a good one. It's a real good one. But there's better. But maybe this is something like that. Wherever we go, this beautiful scent is with us. And people say, wow, you know, whenever I'm around you, I smell this scent. I said, yeah, the scent never leaves me. Or it could just be this feeling like of the atmosphere is just so beautiful, so balmy, this balmy atmosphere. That's the guru. Which is really an expression of our one self, okay? But it's our friend that won't forsake us when the world forsakes us, as it most certainly will. The world is going towards severe fixation upon blindness, upon belief in otherness, and ultimately into believing that psychosis is mental health. Everybody's doing it. Gotta be right. Technology says this is what you're supposed to do. Oh, yes, Moloch. Let's worship the golden calf. So right here, right now, we have put the intention out. We are going to suffer the presence of the guru, if you want to look at it that way. As far as, you know, our nerves go, like, wow, this is amazing. It's really working. You know, wow, this is amazing. It's really happening. It's really working for me. Okay, well. We'll take our time, get used to it. Just like a new pair of shoes. Yeah, what do? You get used to it, right? So we got a new pair of shoes. Great. How many pairs of shoes do I have now? I have a number of pairs of shoes now. I use them for different purposes. Got the skateboard shoes. Got the golf shoes, which I don't use anymore, but I supposedly I'm going to be playing golf coming up at some point here. It's free, but so what, right? Tried my golf swing out yesterday for the first time in a long time. Still powerful. It's not, you know, quite as quick as before when I was practicing all the time. But it's good. It's strong. I haven't lost anything, actually. By not practicing, I haven't lost anything. Except a sore back. That's the only thing I'm missing. Yeah. I mean, you take it back low and long. And this is the key. Low and long. In other words, keep the club low as you take it back and make a long arc. You know, keep it back, take it back a long ways. As long as you can. And then turn your shoulders as much as possible and turn your hips as little as possible. So there's tension between the shoulders and the hips. And then when that tension gets to be, you know, maxed out, then just fire your hips and left knee, if you're a right-handed golfer, fire your left hip and your left knee, you know, fire that towards the target as fast as possible. And that just automatically pulls the shoulders around and you keep your shoulders and arms relaxed. And, okay, that's the basics. And then, again, do the same thing. And then don't set your wrists until the last second. Don't set them too early. Set them real late. Late wrist set, and then late wrist release. Just before you're going to hit the ball, release the wrists like that. Don't do a forward press with your wrists. Do a backward press, I think. It's better backward press. Do forward press that kind of slice it. So your wrist's not like that, but more like that. And finish high. That's it. I'm not going to get into the plane. That's Ben Hogan, you know, the arc. What is your plane? You know, the staying on plane. Well, that you start thinking too much then. You know, if you practice enough, you'll figure it out, be on plane. He says the back of the plane going back, you need to actually flatten it out a little bit going forward. So you go from inside to out. So all you have to do is just flatten your swing a little bit at the top, sort of just feel it flatten out just a couple degrees. But that's it. That's the whole thing. Don't lift your left foot off the ground because that turns your hips too much. You want the tension between the shoulders and the hips. That's the key. That's why the golfers have really strong cores, as they work on those side muscles so they can keep the hips not turning too much and get that tension in their overall core and back tension so that release is really strong and fast. That's how they blast it. There's really nothing else for me to learn, you know. I've got it. So I just, you know, if I just want to work out and keep strengthening my core and everything, which I haven't been doing much lately because it hurts, I can't sleep. But I could do that. I'm still working out today. I did, you know, some legs and arms and stuff. So I try to do something every day. Just got to keep your foot into it, you know. Got to keep doing it. Don't stop completely, but I kind of backed off all the heavy core work because I was really, you know, it was kind of hard to sleep because my whole insides was all kind of shaken from it. Shaking too much. All right, so hot, sultry evening, just poof. So we're saying, okay, Guru, you're showing up. You don't have to show up physical form. If you can't, that's okay too, whatever. Doesn't matter. We're not picky. We're not choosy. Just something, some steady presence, like a friend that's there. Now, I mean, we might have had that steady friend when we were younger, right? They call it your guardian angel or something. It's just the Guru. And then we told it to leave, that people don't like you here, Guru, and so you have to leave. Well, they never left, but you're just not aware of them, so to speak. You know, your awareness is blocking it. But this world tells you, no, you can't have these imaginary friends. You got to grow up out of that. These aren't imaginary friends. They're real friends. It's the world that insists that they're imaginary. So we can say, no, you got to stop insisting that reality is imaginary and that imagination is reality. You're the ones who are steeped in imagination, not me. But I have to have this friend like this in a subtle way because we're so addicted to falsity that it's hard to accept, you know, reality. So the world has it, you know, completely backwards. So, you know, the guru didn't desert us. We told the guru, look, you know, I'm getting too much heat for this. And at some point, they say, I have to leave you, so I better get used to it. That's a mistake. We never have to leave the guru. The guru doesn't leave us. We say that, we got to work on modification, and if you don't leave, I might not get to work on that. So, you know, I got to mature, I got to evolve, I got to get... That's all nonsense. There's nothing to mature, there's nothing to evolve. Is intrinsic spaciousness evolving? We creatively play with display, but nothing's evolving. Nothing's being modified. So, it's like saying, hey, you got to get busy becoming psychotic. That's what the world tells you. Oh, you can't have that guru. You won't become psychotic then, like us. Well, oh, gee, guess what? I think this lifetime I'm going to pass on that. Maybe some other lifetime way down the road I'll get into that. But right now, it doesn't interest me at all. Bueno, okay. Who knows, Juan Carlos may be showing up sometime here soon. Along with Uncle Ross. Just talking in plain language, you know, my cousin. I don't know where he's from. Sometimes I think he might be from South Carolina, y'all. But he's back in the corner of the woods that just... You know, it's kind of a mixture of everything. Got a little bit of everything there. So yeah, you never know what's going to show up. You better get used to something showing up. Like, oh wow, that's cool. Didn't expect that to show up. The guru shows up. So time for the guru to show up. It's our choice, our decision. For this lifetime, we'll decide that. And in another one, we'll see how it goes, you know. So we're not rebuffing anybody. I mean, we've got eternity, by gosh sake. So it's just right now, we got to play it safe, okay? Things are getting too weird, too psychotic, too crazy. And so for now, we're going to play it safe. So we're going back to, you know, God's ways instead of the ego's ways. Because the ego, you know, we got to have an ace up our sleeve. Because what if the ego's psychosis thing does? What if we can't modify what we are? Then what? You see? So we've got to have an ace up our sleeves, or else we're just, you know, going to be up a creek without a paddle. And everyone says, "Well, that's what we're doing." We, you know, well, again, psychosis doesn't love company. So I'm not going to be any good to you anyway. If you go down that route, it doesn't matter what I do. I won't be able to please you at all. So might as well, you know, please myself. If I can't please you, I'll at least please myself. We'll have the guru hang out and. So that's at least one is winning, and then later on, if you want a win-win, then that'll be available. So that's just, you know, a nice safeguard in case the ego's plan doesn't work. And they say, well, you got to have faith to make it work. Well, what can't work won't work. Okay. They say, no, we can do everything. Well, if the belief in we can do everything doesn't work, then it doesn't work. Then what? So, we need the presence of the gurus, really. Because this stuff just can't handle it, you know. Because if we feel friendless, it's too tough. It's too tough. So I said, well, if I feel friendless, I'm going to plunge into psychosis with you. So it's going to be a lose-lose. I already know it's going to be a lose. That's no fun for me, then. I mean, at least you have hope it'll be a win, but it won't. So, I can't be expected to do a lose-lose thing. And they say, well, we'll think you're crazy. I say, well, yeah, you will. But the guru doesn't think I'm crazy, so I'll be fine. Don't worry. So, auspicious day. Calling on the guru. Stay tuned to this channel. Stay tuned to Facebook if you want to like me on Facebook. Or follow me. Facebook. /ClarityRoss, facebook.com/ClarityRoss. And, you know, I post there, I like, I comment, very genial presence, you know, congenial, like, happy presence, thanks for showing up, positive vibes, you know, and there's a lot of good posts there. I friend people if they do really good posts, non-dual posts. I like that. You know, they themselves may not be practicing. They may be practicing a little. They may be, you know, insisting that, you know, we can find a way to modify ourselves and not really getting with it. But still, non-dual considerations are helpful. It's like, at least we say the medicine is here. They're not taking the medicine, but they're saying, huh, medicine. I like that, medicine. Great medicine, yeah. At least, you know, it's they've got the hand on the bottle kind of thing, the medicine. And maybe practicing a little bit, but they're scared to go any further. So maybe I'm helping them, saying, look, if you go further, believe me, I've already gone further. So don't worry about it. It's fine. Come on in. The water's cool. I think Uncle Ross will invite you in the water. Say, come on down, folks. The water's fine. Okay. You sure? Yeah. Okay. Let's check it out. Hey, it is fine. Nice to have that nice water as our friend, huh? Cool water. Water's on my mind because it's so hot today. It would be nice to have like this shimmering pool of cool water being surrounded by it right now. 360-degree shimmering cool pool of water. And sometimes I just feel like getting in some water would be nice. And we just don't have it anymore around here, you know. It's just the pool culture is not happening here. And today might be a good day to go to the ocean. You know, I should have gone to the ocean and just get in the water. I had the time to do it, and it wasn't working. But, shoot. I can't do it tomorrow. I gotta get up, I think, early and do something. Maybe later, just go over to the ocean and just, it'll probably be foggy by that time. Had a dream of the ocean last night. It was scary. The ocean, I was trying to walk along the beach, and the waves kept coming up higher and higher and higher until finally they were hitting the cliff and then washing back, threatening to sweep me out to sea. I said, whoa, this is getting to be too much now. So I said, I got to turn around and go back. You know, I can't go in this direction anymore. I got to go back to safety. So I think it has to do with the world and the tide, and it's getting too freaky now. Okay, the ocean's getting too tempestuous, meaning the collective psyche of the planet here is getting too much now. Okay. So. Yeah, I just said, uh-oh, I don't like this. And I was thinking, should I stick it out? Maybe I said, you know, let's just be safe in this one. Let's be safe. Be humble, be safe. Be humble, be safe. Let's go back to our car, to our vehicle. Let's get off the beach, so to speak, and hang out with the guru. And maybe some other life will go for this modification thingy, you know, but not right now. We know we don't want to get swept out to sea. No. That's psychosis. Getting swept out into an angry, tempestuous ocean. You try that and see how you feel. There's nobody out there, just the angry ocean. Yeah, then you're lonely surfer boy or girl. The lonely surfer girl. Ooh. That's too much lonely. Okay, that's way too much lonely. So, got to back away. It could also be the practices, you know, the causing the, you know, disturbance in our psyche. The ocean gets disturbed. And need to remember, go at your practices gently, not super aggressively. Don't do it aggressively. This is a problem. Do it gently. There was a bee on our screen door, inside the screen door. I said, what's that? Oh my gosh, a bee. So I kind of just like flicked at it, kind of get off. It didn't work. Then I said, got to get that bee off. It's really grabbing hold of the screen. What do I do? There's a broom there, so I was ready to grab the broom and just use the broom. Just whoosh. I said, wait a minute, that's going to injure the bee or kill the bee. So why should I kill the bee just because, you know, it's ridiculous. It's just hanging onto a screen door. So then I leaned down and looked at it carefully, and then I took my finger and just very gently, right by its side, on its side there, I just got and just sort of flicked it like that, real nice and soft and gentle. And the bee fell off outside and walked away, you know. It's fine. And so we need to be like this in our practicing. We need to be gentle. We need to be very gentle in our practicing. Okay, very gentle. Do it, you know, be intrepid. Like I approached the bee, gave it my full attention and got it outside. I was determined to do so, but do it gently. So do the practices, but be kind to yourself, be gentle to yourself. As I said on a Facebook post, the non-existent self is very sensitive about its non-existence. So be kind to it. Be gentle to it. It's okay to still be absurd for a little while. You know, it's okay. That, too, is already just decoration of intrinsic spaciousness. That's already that. So be kind to the non-existent self. It's upset that it's it doesn't exist. At least we think it is upset, right? It's absurdity, of course, but be kind to our absurdity, our habit of absurdity. Don't be too harsh on yourself. Don't force the issue. You might get swept into the ocean, right? You don't want that. But we do have to do something. So this is the thing. We can't default and say, oh, there's nothing we could do. Let's let the nice bee stay inside. What can we do? Oh, you know, this is the ridiculous side that there's so many in the world. It's like, and then when someone else says, no, we got to get the bee outside. Okay, got to do that. Everyone goes, wow, no, you'll hurt the bee. No, leave it alone. Let it. I said, no, there's a way to do it without, by being gentle. No, you got. I don't like your attitude. Too decisive, too determined. It's just scary. No, it's not. Determination can be very gentle. In fact, the more determined we are, often the more gentle we can be. We just say, "I'm going to do this. I know I'm going to do this. I'm committed to it. Therefore, I don't have to panic." We use excessive force when we panic. But if we're really focused and determined, say, "No, I'll get that bee one way or the other. Let me try the gentle approach here. This should work. Let's hope. I hope it works. That worked fine." So do the practices, but don't be harsh on yourself. Just be kind, patient, gentle, kind, patient, gentle, kind, patient, gentle. Thank the non-existent self for its cooperation, its non-existent cooperation. Thank absurdity for not kicking up too much of a fuss. Keep in mind, I left the realm of the absurd. They set me free. The realm of the absurd is this world, okay? That's what it is. We're all madly absurd. And they set me free. The king of absurdity, the committee, you know, it wasn't just one. They all took a vote. They all voted, and they voted that I'm okay. They're going to let me go. It's pretty amazing, that dream I had. It's one of the most extraordinary dreams you can ever possibly have. So many times they promised to set me free and then freaked out at the last moment. Like, ah, I can't do it. I said, I'm just ready to walk away. I said, we decided you can't go. I said, I just crushed my hopes, you know. This time, they said, okay, go talk to the king, the real king, and please put in a good word for us, okay? We really need some help here. I said, okay, I'll do it. They said, we know you can go talk to the king. The king will listen to you. I said, so you got to promise to do that. I said, okay, I promise to do that. They let me go. So I come back and I tell them, this is what the king has said. You know, this is the things that shift, just shift into the purpose of your dream. So, you know, but I tell them kindly so they don't feel too forced or pressured. Yeah, maybe some are listening, but I'm the one that the absurdists, the lunatics who are running the asylum here, they set me free. I'm that rare one that was set free. They set me free. I say, go. You can go now. We trust you. You know, you won't try to force things with us. You won't be harsh and unkind, you know. You have some compassion for us, you know, and we know that you're committed to helping us. And they admitted, you know, we're not you know, we're not really sure. There's something wrong with us. We're not sure what it is, but yeah, I mean, definitely there's something wrong with us. So, yeah. Well, there's nothing wrong with their minds. They're just playing this game of arrogance. And continuity fear is the problem. So, we ask for the presence of the guru, plain and simple. It's guru time, okay? I know there's a gurus touring. There's a couple of gurus from India that are here. There's a one, I know there, you know, there's one that's nice, was it Ramakant or something like that. I don't quite have it right. He's from Nisargadatta Maharaj, a direct disciple of Nisargadatta Maharaj. And he says he's enlightened, and what he says is very compelling. And there's another one, was it Sadhguru or something? He's here touring. So they're going around. And they're going around. But you know, round, get around. Woo, I get around. I'm getting tired driving around. I'm getting tired driving on the same old street. I gotta drive. What was it? Gotta find. I'm getting tired driving up and down the same old strip. I gotta find a new place where the kids are hip. My buddies and me were getting real well known. Yeah, the bad guys know us and they leave us alone. I get around, round, get around. I get around down the town. Sometimes in the morning, my voice, I can hit all the high notes in the Beach Boys. All of them. I get around, don't worry, baby. Fun. You know, you name it. I can hit all the high notes. That's pretty cool. So, yeah. But I got to sing quietly. That's fun. Anyway, they're getting around. But what we're calling on is the gurus to actually to appear and stay with us as our friend, not touring anywhere. These are the bodhisattvas, the high bodhisattvas, the Dharma kings. We're asking the gurus that show up and don't leave to show up right now. People show up to these gurus, they're very earnest, very serious. Okay, how can I be happy? How can I, this human being here living in this in my reality, planet Earth, and how can we be happy here? We've got to do something, you know. So it's ripe for gurus to tour right now because everybody's going into a psychosis, and they're saying, how can I be happy with my psychosis? Well, you know, and they give, you know, some advice of stop seeking for happiness. Oh, okay, yeah. Huh. Hmm. Read my book, okay. Yeah, all right. Okay. That's something, all right? It's something. But we're asking for a little bit more than that. Maybe a lot more than that. Because we're comfortable doing so. This is where we're at. This is, you know, graduate students, this is the time. You ask for more. You have you get a PhD, you have to have a PhD advisor, okay? If you don't get accepted in the program until an advisor agrees to act as your advisor. Advising you, say, this is what I, you know, advise you to focus on, or advise you to look in this direction, or advising you, help you, mentor you through the PhD program. You can't just don't do it by yourself. So we need this, like, advisor now, right? To just, a mentor, spiritual mentor, to be with us. We need Juan Carlos, come on, we need Juan Carlos, we need a spiritual mentor. We're just keeping it fun that way, okay? So we have a laugh. It helps us laugh about it. But the idea is very serious. Spiritual mentor. We need a spiritual mentor to show up. Friend, spiritual friend. They're not here to really teach us much of anything. It's just, look, I'm here as your friend. That's it. If you want some advice, maybe I'll give you some, but I'm not going to press it on you or anything. I just here. I'm just letting you know I'm here. I'm not going to leave you. When the world abandons you, I won't abandon you. Maybe a whole group of friends will show up, possible. And people say, oh, you're psychotic, you're saving your friends. No, you're the ones who are psychotic, who think that you're all alone, and there are no gurus, and there's no the grace of God to reassure you when the world tries to abandon you. That's what's psychotic, that's what's crazy. It's like you're saying, I got no help. That leads to psychosis, doesn't it? Of course it does. Most people feel they don't have any help. They go to church, say, Jesus this, and then I died for your sins, and they go home. It's like, I don't know, I wish I had a little more help than that. So, what is it? Off to Facebook land, or actually editing, video editing land. Got a lot of video to edit. I know not every song, every video hits home with everyone. It's like the Beatles, you know, Beach Boys. Make an album, Beach Boys, and it's like, wow, I love a lot of songs. Some, not so much. That's okay. I mean, a lot of if I do one, I think it's really artistic, and just like, and some people just like, it's like, nah, blah, didn't do anything for me. Different style, they like different styles, that's fine. I do something else in different style, I love that one. So on a Beach Boy record, there might be like, I might have 4 or 5 songs I really love, and then the other ones are like, not so great. I remember I used to get the greatest hits. I'd always try to go for greatest hits because I like every song on them, you know. Chuck Berry's greatest hits. I had that record. I played that record endlessly, Chuck Berry's greatest hits, because I learned, you know, rock and roll from Chuck Berry, pretty much so. As many of us did. Maybelline, why can't you be true? Oh, Maybelline, why can't you be true? You done going back doing the things you used to do, you know. Yeah, it's like every song was nice. Greatest hits. Even on the Beach Boys CD I have now, there's a section of it, I just bypass it all. It's like, nah. Just let me hear some of that rock and roll music. That's a Chuck Berry one, too. They don't do it very well. You know, Wild Honey, I don't like that one song. So some are not nearly as good. Then you get to the good ones, like Good Timing, I Can Hear Music, Good Vibrations. Then you get, you know, the California Girls, I Get Around, Help Me Rhonda, Don't Worry Baby, When I Grew Up to Be a Man, Dance, and, you know, the rest of them. Surfer Girl, boom, 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 woo, woo. Bum, bum, bum. What a great song that is. Just awesome. Every time I hear it, just like, yeah. Gosh. And, you know, Shut Down. Little Deuce Coupe. Songs like that. The car songs. It's like, wow. Great, 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 great. She'll have fun, till her daddy takes the T-Bird away. So, if there's a video just that doesn't strike your fancy, that's fine. Don't worry about it. I'm not going to tell you how it's supposed to strike your fancy. You know, it's like a musician saying, "Oh, you don't like that song? Well, let me explain to you what we're trying to convey here in the song." And you're still not going to like the song. Okay. So as a musician, you just got to let it go. You know, you like some, they don't like others. So you find out with the favorites, and okay. So it's really like that. Don't worry, baby. Everything will be all right. But I very much appreciate all those who enjoy the different styles of videos. I'm doing some different styles now. And, you know, it's helpful because we have to take it lightly. Yeah, the gurus are going to help us. Okay. Well, we have to get in that mood. You know, I'm in this this happy mood of like, wow, I've got a great friend. I got great friends. Awesome friends. I got Juan Carlos is my friend. You know, this is awesome. I know this guy comes breezing in a Ferrari, you know, he's Juan Carlos, like, wow, he says, hello, amigos, ¿cómo estás? How are you? Great to see you, you know, and it's like, ah, wow, that's cool. I mean, let's admit it, it would be pretty cool to have a really, really super cool friend, right? I mean, don't we all want that in some way? Sure we do. So we need to acknowledge this. You know, it'd be kind of nice to have a real hillbilly friend too, you know, someone who's like real down home and country. That's also cool to have. I kind of like to have one super sophisticated Juan Carlos and then Uncle Ross. Those are like, you know, it'd be nice to have friends like that. Says, hey, Uncle Ross, don't worry, man, don't worry. We know how to, we go fishing in the morning, but plenty to eat, you know. Pick some corn, go fishing, go hunting, fishing. Yeah, we ain't gonna starve out here. No worries, man. We got the wood stove, chop some wood. We're fine. We're off the grid. We know how to live off the grid, no problem. It'd be nice to have friends like that, wouldn't it? Then Juan Carlos is from, you know, he's from the higher realms, and he's just like, you know, not everything's fine where I come from. Everything's perfect, as a matter of fact. I don't have any problem of confidence, you know. What, me worry, confidence? Are you kidding me? Are you kidding? It's a joke. You make a joke. There's no problem. He sometimes has a slight Italian accent because all his friends are Italian. All his Italian racers, you know. He's on the Ferrari team. So he's got he has a little bit of Italian leaked into his Spanish. But, you know, everything's beautiful, you know. Look at me. Everything's fine. Everything's beautiful. I'm so happy. I got no problems. I'm so relaxed. It's okay. Isn't that great to have a friend like that? Oh, are you kidding me? We deserve a friend like that, you know. We deserve it. We deserve to have great friends. I'm looking for them on Facebook, but, you know, I can't find the great friends. No. So, again, you know, don't constrain yourself. Say, no, I gotta stay serious. That's the ego saying, what do you mean? You gotta get into the right ambience, the right mood, the right acceptance of great friendship that will not abandon you when you shift over to vision of intrinsic spaciousness. You gotta have someone Juan Carlos says, hey, he's my friend. I'm visiting him. Why? Because he's my friend. Nobody tells me who I can visit. What are you talking to Juan Carlos here? Nobody, you know, I come see who I want to see. I go where I want to go. Nobody can catch me. I drive too fast. Don't worry. It's all beautiful. And so you want someone like that who says, if I want to visit you, I'm going to visit you. I don't care what anyone says. I'm a super celebrity, you know. Everything's okay. Everybody that says, it's Juan Carlos, okay. What can they say? Can they say no to Juan Carlos? No, I don't think so. It's not possible, right? Not possible. They can't find him. Why? Because sometimes he doesn't want to be found. He's too fast. He's everywhere. So, you know, feel the vibe of this. If it happens, hopefully I can do some more of this. We'll see. Callie Ross, you know, is another one. Yeah, Callie Ross hanging out in Cali. Just let's go hug trees today, you know. Or not. You know, it's so beautiful. I don't even need to hug trees. It's already being hugged by the weather. You know, weather's hugging everything out here, man. It's like, what do I have to do? Nothing. I just hang out. With the friendship here, it's all friendship here. The weather's my friend. So actually, in California, we feel the weather's our friend. So it does give us some sort of. It's helped me out when people abandoned me. Everyone abandoned me, orphaned me. The weather didn't abandon me. But when the weather goes bad here, which it hasn't gone bad in about 5 years, then I get really freaked out, get desperate. I say, I gotta go to the desert. You know, I got to find good weather because the weather's my friend, actually. Because really here, no, everybody abandoned me. They said, no, 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 you're crazy. You're talking about these gurus. You're talking about all this stuff and you're in contact with them. You're nuts. They stay away from me. So they abandoned me. But the weather didn't abandon me. But there was, you know, it's, but it used to be, there were times when the weather wasn't so good, occasionally. That's really, I struggled terribly. I felt like, ah, I'm totally abandoned, free. But the last 5 years, there hasn't been a day that has gone by that wasn't, felt like a friend to me. Not a day. So, part of what I do, I just want to thank California, you know, seriously, to be, what a great friend it's been. I could never have made it without this weather. You get up in a day like this, just dawn's so gorgeous. The whole day is so gorgeous. The evening is so gorgeous. It's so gentle, you know. It's just gently gorgeous. And it's just with you 360 degrees, right? It's everywhere. So I want to say to California, thank you from you know, the fullness of my spirit for giving us just this fantastic friendship that is with us every day, all day, like a guru. And may the ambience get even better. May we step into it, even if you allow me, California, to step into an even better ambience, because you prepared me for it. We'll see if California will set me free to experience an even more perfect ambience, like the denizens of this insane realm set me free. Maybe California will set me free and say, okay, here, you can experience something that's even more perfect. Possible. I tend to do well with ambience, the weather. That tends to be my friend. So maybe, in my case, it will just be this feeling of perfect weather. I got this morning. Actually, I've been having this a sudden remembrance of some sort of perfect ambience. Sudden remembrance of some sort of perfect weather ambience. It's happened to me now. It's starting to happen to me last couple of days. And I just say, wow. That's how I used to feel. I used to feel this ambience. And they say, well, don't worry. California has a nice ambience for you, too. You can drop that one, California. And, of course, it's not as good. But it's been good enough to bridge me back to what's really great. It's not California's fault that people use it to lure you out of your spiritual ambience. And California's been helping us the last 5 years here, just producing these gorgeous days that make us remember, hey, there's something, I remember like some ambience is like even better than this. This is so good, but I remember something's even better. It helps us in this way. So don't overthink the situation. Like when the perfect ambience dawns upon you, don't overthink it. It's just the form of the guru. This is how your friend is showing up. Just say, okay, I have a friend now. This ambience is simply my friend. That's all. Don't overthink it. You know what it's for, because you're going to choose to experience intrinsic spaciousness, just to see that as primary. Okay. So it's to keep you friend. That's what it's for. That's what it's for. So don't overthink it. Don't analyze it. Don't try to describe it. You try to analyze and describe a friend. Why? The friend still is with you. Just experience the friend. Don't say, okay, now, how can I tell people about this friend, describe the friend, this and this, and as if the friend's not there. And you go into the shell of analyzing. Don't analyze. The friend is here. The friend is here to stay. It's here to help. Accept the help. Get used to it. crickets have started now, haven't they? Maybe California will get so emotional, so happy that I've accepted something greater, that it'll cry so many tears it'll rain like crazy this winter. I have a feeling it's going to rain a lot here this winter. A lot. It needs to. So I say, okay, thanks, California. Now you need to rain and need to green up the state again, okay? Because we're so dry. So if someone is liberated from this atmosphere into a pure atmosphere, California can say, oh, great. At least I helped someone out. I did good. Now I can rain a bit. You know, not such good weather. Need rainy weather here. But even that, we'll say it's great weather. But no, once you experience the good stuff, I want the good stuff. Go on, sunshine. We love our sunshine here. Okay, great day. So, give a different purpose to California. Many say, oh, I don't need the spirit. The weather's so great here, it's good enough. But I say, California, you're reminding me of what I really want. You're helping remind me of what I love so much, this perfect ambience, feeling a perfect ambience. So thank you for reminding me of that so beautifully. So I have a different take on it. Super positive take on it all. All right. So, we don't gotta go too long here. Very great. I gotta do my editing and look at the posts of the Facebook friends. There's amazing posters, nonstop posts, but I don't know where they get all this stuff. I'm not gonna even compete. I can't hang. You know, they just every day, so many posts, unique posts. They just must spend collective. I don't know how they do it. They share it onto their timeline and it shows up on your feed, news feed. They're scavenging the everywhere for these happy, positive, uplifting little memes, little posts, graphics with letter, you know, a message on them. Beautiful pictures and everything. It's just amazing, you know, what's out there. But of course, we're asking for the real thing, the real McCoy here, the actual presence. We're accepting actual presence in our life now, actual presence. So here we go. Fasten our seatbelts. And, of course, Juan Carlos will say, what's the problem? No problem. Of course. Presence. You gotta have presence. That's what I have. I have presence. Okay. Very great. That's it.